Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Seeker Plus, where we take deep dives into one topic. I'm your host, Julian Huguet, and today we're going to explore a place that's been neglected for far too long. And no, I'm not talking about the office chair in my bedroom that's covered in laundry that's not quite dirty enough to wash. Maybe you could wear it once or twice more. I'm talking about someplace a little more mysterious than that. I'm talking about Venus, our solar system neighbor, often dubbed Earth's evil twin. And if you think it's a bit harsh calling Venus evil, well, then you just try living there and you tell me otherwise, because it is no picnic. The conditions on the planet are terrible. Consider this, its surface temperature is hot enough to melt lead. The atmospheric pressure would crush you even if you were inside a nuclear-powered submarine. There's no liquid water on the planet. It's got toxic, toxic clouds, and it forgot my birthday last month. All right, well, other than that last point, the planet is actually a terrible, inhospitable place that scientists have had a hard time studying. I'd even go so far as to argue that we have an easier time studying Saturn and Jupiter than Venus, which is a lot closer. In this series, we're going to unpack some mysteries, explain how the planet got so unforgiving in the first place, why 127 minutes is the number to beat for keeping space probes alive on Venus, take that, James Franco, and what plans NASA has for future exploration. That was 127 hours reference, in case anybody remembers that movie. Anyway, if by the end of this series you still think Venus isn't so bad, then maybe you're the evil twin. But for now, let's look at how Venus compares to Earth. As the similarities go, Earth is only about 5% larger than Venus. The two planets weigh almost the same, with Earth again edging Venus out, and they both have iron cores surrounded by a mantle of silicate rock. The prevailing solar system origin theory even suggests that Venus and Earth formed roughly about the same time, around 4.5 billion years ago, when a nebula condensed into the sun and heavy, rocky materials formed the inner terrestrial planets. These reasons explain why Venus gets the twin moniker, but it's where the similarities end and where the evil part begins. Compared to Earth, Venus has a thick, toxic atmosphere filled with carbon dioxide, which really puts a YouTube comment section to shame. There are clouds of sulfuric acid, yes, clouds of acid, which are so thick and unrelenting they trap heat in the atmosphere. This runaway greenhouse effect explains why, despite not being the closest planet to the sun, it's actually the hottest in our solar system, clocking in at around 475 degrees Celsius. If you somehow managed to withstand those temperatures at the surface, you'd probably have a hard time keeping your body upright. That's because the atmospheric pressure at the surface is over 90 times that of Earth. It's like having over 1,300 pounds of pressure pressing down on each square inch of your body. Now, before you yell at me for my choice of units, I picked them because I think if I used metric, you wouldn't know what I meant. Like if I said that's like having 9 million newtons per square meter on your body, does that, you have any sense of that? That's what I thought. But I'll put it another way for all you metric heads. According to NASA, you'd get that same pressure if you were about 1.6 kilometers deep under the ocean. There you go. You happy? So, poisonous atmosphere? Check. Scorching temperatures? Check. Crushing pressures? Check. It's like playing in the Super Bowl in Los Angeles. Do I need to go on? Well, I do and I will, in case you, I don't know, stepped away for a second. Let me really hammer it home. Venus also has no water on its surface. So, in a hypothetical scenario where you've flown to Venus, plummeted through the thick yellowish clouds of sulfuric acid, withstood grueling temperatures, and survived not getting crushed to death by the atmosphere, unfortunately, you wouldn't have any sweet, sweet liquid water to keep you alive either. Now, to some, Venus may sound like a lost cause, but the planet we know today may not have always been that way. You remember how I mentioned earlier that Earth and Venus formed around the same time, around 4.5 billion years ago, when both planets were just coming into their own as baby planets do. Back then, the sun was much dimmer, placing Venus firmly inside the habitable zone, the region around a star that would allow for liquid water to exist on the planet's surface. At that time, it's believed that not only liquid water existed on the surface, but the planet had a stable climate and cooler temperatures, both of which would have been more amenable to some form of life. While no one is sure at what point things changed and why, we do know that something happened. One idea involves the sun. Since this glowing ball of hydrogen and helium is a yellow dwarf star, it brightens as it ages. So it's possible that Venus started to warm up and began to move towards the edge of the habitable zone. As this happened, the oceans on Venus's surface evaporated and water vapor moved up into its atmosphere. Once too much water vapor reached the atmosphere, it kicked off a runaway greenhouse effect, creating clouds that got too thick, trapping heat, and further increasing the surface temperature, which caused more water to move into the atmosphere, and so on and so forth. I think you get the idea. Basically, the planet began to suffocate itself over many years. So that's the slow death version for Venus. The other suspect worked a lot faster to turn Venus into the hellscape that we know today. This theory suggests that volcanoes, and I'm talking massive, world-killing, apocalyptic, multiple extinction-level volcanoes, erupted around the same time. It's like if 2020, 2021, and 2022 were volcanoes. And they released so much carbon dioxide into the atmosphere that the planet's heat was trapped. This boiled off its oceans, which in turn trapped more heat, creating a feedback cycle that couldn't be stopped. Plate tectonics, if Venus had any, would have shut down because they use water as a lubricant so the plates can slide around. Without it, the system can't bury carbon deep in the planet, so CO2 eventually became the dominant gas in the atmosphere. Today, that one gas makes up about 96% of the planet's atmosphere, compared to less than 0.05% of Earth's. Now, the jury is still out on which cataclysm did Venus in. Both scenarios are still up for debate at the moment. You may even be wondering, so what? What does it matter how Venus died? What does the death of Venus have to do with me? Well, actually a lot, Dave. I'm kidding, it doesn't pertain specifically to Dave's, but can you imagine everyone named Dave listening just now? They would have been freaked out. Anyway, while perfectly habitable Venus was becoming not that, its neighbor, our lovely blue planet Earth, was also going through some changes. Those awkward teen years, you know, Earth was just kind of forming and figuring itself out, dealing with what type of planet it wanted to be in the solar system. Would it follow the same tragic fate as Venus, or go down its own path? Well, after a few bumps in the road, aka nearly planet-killing asteroids and mega-volcanoes, Earth began to stabilize a bit. Its atmosphere kept the planet comfortable enough for life to start to thrive, and we remained in the habitable zone. Now, forgive me for completely glossing over the mega-volcanoes and massive space rocks that almost turned Earth into its neighbor. I know it sounds awesome, but there's so much to unpack there. We need a whole other series on Earth's multiple extinction-level events to cover them. Actually, that's a good idea. If you want to learn more about how Earth kept rebounding, let me know in the comments. Anyway, back to what I was saying about Venus. Earth was spared a fate similar to Venus, sometimes by luck, sometimes just because of different environmental conditions. On one level, by studying what happened to Venus, we can learn how other Earth-like planets evolve, take shape, and what conditions cause these exoplanets to either flourish or die. Studying Venus can even show scientists that the habitable zone can move, which could mean that an exoplanet may have had life at one point in its history and could harbor life again if conditions change. While that opens up a ton of questions about terraforming, which, no matter what anyone says, is still very far away, if it will happen at all, there are more direct links closer to home. For instance, studying the sulfuric acid clouds on Venus offers scientists a natural way to study haze in our own atmosphere. These studies can improve our climate models so that we may know what we could be dealing with in the future. That's not all when it comes to thinking about greenhouse gases. Venus is a cautionary tale, reminding us how much can change on a planet because of its climate. Of course, Venus is the worst-case scenario, the poster child for the greenhouse effect. But if it can happen on a planet that was potentially full of liquid water and habitable, well, then it could happen almost anywhere. Now, I don't want to end on doom and gloom. It's so incredibly unlikely that what happened on Venus will happen to Earth today. I don't even want to leave the impression that that's in the cards. It's not. Instead, what I do want to leave us thinking about is how little we still know about our neighboring planet. There's so many mysteries and questions about this fascinating, terrifying, and very, very deadly world that keep me up at night. Like, what exactly is lurking beneath the thick clouds? Why does the planet keep killing every spacecraft we send there? What are you hiding from us, Venus? We'll get to all that and more in the next episode of Seeker Plus. Thanks for watching. If you like this episode, be sure to like and subscribe. And as you can tell, Venus is such a weird, interesting place. There's so much I couldn't cover in this episode. Like, did you know that a day on Venus is longer than a year? What? If you know any other fun facts about Venus or another planet, let us know. And Elon, I know you're watching. We know you want to talk about Mars. We'll talk about Mars, but you got to move on. There are other planets out there, okay, bud? All right, thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you for the next episode of Seeker Plus.